Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Zone War by John Conroe, narrated by James Patrick Cronin. Chapter 1. And now for today's edition of Zone War. Viewers are warned that this presentation may include sudden images of extreme graphic violence, including death. This production is unscripted and carried live in unedited format for an authentic viewing experience. Under no circumstances should any viewer attempt to enter the Manhattan Drone Zone without explicit authorization by the Department of Zone Defense Exclusion Authority. All of the salvage and bounty personnel depicted are duly licensed and trained professionals. There are no amateurs in Zone War, and Flottercott Productions is not liable for any injuries or deaths incurred by viewers of this program. In other words, do not try this yourself. Of course, I had to cross the living room at that exact moment, my bowl of ice cream balanced on my work tablet. I had timed my foray into the kitchen with exacting precision, determined to be in and out in under 2 minutes, which was the amount of time till that blasted show started. The rest of my family was huddled around the viewing wall in anticipation of the daily showing of what was currently the most popular reality show in the world. Not being able to find the ice cream scoop had foiled my plan. The screen melted from the skyline background with floating words to a live feed showing bouncing footage of one of downtown Manhattan's deserted streets, husks of cars littered about, a stoplight lying on the road. The sun was out, and the camera mounted on the outside of the light-armored vehicle was broadcasting a clear, high-def picture, even if it was shaky from the vehicle's ride. Catching the opening scene was my first piece of bad luck. The second was Monique catching sight of me in the corner of her eye.
Hey, AJ's here. You gonna watch it with us this time? Or hide in your room?
I'm going to work in my room, little sister, so that we can get paid for what I brought out yesterday, I said. The little sister part was ill-advised on my part, as it was guaranteed to trigger her twin's temper. Gabby whipped around on the couch and glared at me.
Oh, is Big Brother busy saving the day?
14-year-old girls should come with the same kind of hazardous warning labels used for explosives and poisons. I'd rather face the zone any day than get drawn into a verbal war with my lethal little sisters, who fire off words faster than a Russian wolf anti-personnel drone fires fletchets.
Gabby, enough. Ajaya's work is important to this family, and you know it. All of our BUIs together aren't enough to support us, even with your father's death benefit,
my mother said, shutting down the more volatile of the twins. Then she turned my way.
And you, Ajaya Edward Gurung, how many times have I warned you about arrogance?
I wasn't being arrogant, Mom. I was making the point that I have other things to do besides watch that crap, especially when I can see it in person any day I want, if I want to take the risk of being near them, I said, moderating my tone. Behind my mother, the terrible twins both raised their hands and enacted individual ceremonial displays of the middle finger. Monique chose to pull off the imaginary top of her middle finger lipstick and apply a liberal dose to her lips, while Gabrielle blew into her thumb to inflate her own middle digit. My eyes flicked their way and then back to my mother, whose face had taken on her stoic look. The one where she tries not to crumble for fear of my weekly forays into what was regularly described by the Zone War narrator as the most dangerous place on Earth. And it was. Take the island of Manhattan, release over 25,000 highly advanced Russian, Chinese, and Indian autonomous war drones in a single stunning act of terrorism, and let simmer for 10 years. The result was the one borough of New York City that was completely devoid of human inhabitants and whose artificially intelligent denizens aggressively kept it that way. It was estimated that over 372,000 people lost their lives in the first week of the Manhattan attack. Another 23,000 died during the second week as rescue operations and military units counterattacked. Only a crazy fast response by U.S. Special Operations Ready Reaction Teams in coordination with New York National Guard, FBI, NYPD, and a whole alphabet of other federal groups kept the drones from escaping into the other four boroughs. The whole world almost died as an enraged America brought the doomsday clock to 11:59 and 59 seconds, saved by uncharacteristic transparency on the part of Russia, India, and China,
who all stepped up to provide assistance and data about their drone weapon systems, and particularly against the terrorists. 10 years later, the terrorists who were responsible, the Gaia Group, were completely obliterated, hunted with a chilling ruthlessness by a fiercely unified United States. The Burrow Island, however, was still a no-man's land, and a rich one at that. Everyone in Manhattan either fled or died in not much more than a few days' time. One of the wealthiest communities on Earth became empty so fast that countless riches, both literal and information-based, were left lying around for anyone to pick up. Anyone who could get safely past the lethal new owners, that is. Hence, Zone War, a show that followed 5 salvage teams as they braved the Zone on a regular basis to kill drones and pull out abandoned riches. The Zone was also the source of my income. The money that kept my family afloat after Wall Street crashed, was abandoned, then relocated piecemeal to backup sites around the East Coast. The massive worldwide recession that followed dwarfed all others before it. 10 years later, the world economy was just now starting to see the sprouts of fiscal recovery. Yes, we all received the basic universal income checks that were paid out to all Americans, but that wasn't enough to do more than cover bare necessities, as Mom had said. Zone War was a huge success, a show that followed the flashiest and noisiest salvage teams, and none of them made more noise than Johnson Recovery. "Oh, Ajaya, there is your girl," Amma said from her spot between my sisters. My father's mother is quite the romantic. Both of my sisters turned and gave me their best smirks. I ignored them, but I couldn't quite bring myself to ignore the monitor. On screen, the camera had switched to the face of the LAV driver, the blonde, blue-eyed Scandinavian goddess of the drone hunt, Astrid Johnson. The youngest member of Johnson Recovery, aka Team Johnson, Astrid was the principal LAV driver, but also filled the role of Overwatch sharpshooter when more than 2 of the team deployed from their armored vehicle. A beautiful, smart, and very tough girl, she was hugely popular across the nation, and probably most of the globe. A role model for girls and an object of fantasy for guys of all ages. I've known her since we were both 10. Only her oldest brother, JJ, was as popular. Tall, muscular, and bold, JJ was the JR point man for ground deployments, and his media nickname was Thor, possibly because of the big sledgehammer he used to break into buildings, possibly because of his blonde good looks. Women sure seemed to dig him. You had to give him his due. Even with full body armor, he took enormous risks every time he stepped foot on Manhattan soil, mostly due to his father's preferred approach to things. Drive fast and loud, shoot everything in sight, and then haul ass back out at extreme speed. Right on cue, the camera view switched to show JJ crouching with his father, Brad, just behind the driver's seat. Brad Johnson, or Colonel Brad Johnson, was ex-US Army. He'd started his career in tanks, then moved into a striker brigade combat team, and never looked back. He and the rest of his family were in Manhattan visiting an old military friend on the night the drones were released. They escaped, as did their host family. Drone night was a life-changing event for anyone who survived it, and Brad Johnson was as affected as anyone, maybe more so. Within a year, Brad had quit the military and the Johnsons had relocated to Brooklyn. Brad started Zone salvage work even as the military was still permanently blockading the island. He started work with his military friend, an ex-British SAS sniper named Babaram Gurung, my father. Eventually, they had a falling out over work methods and went their separate ways. I turned away from the show and walked out of the room, down the hall and into my bedroom, which is also my office. Time to make some money. Chapter 2. Status, I asked.
Current bids on items 1 through 10, 12, and 14 are all below reserve level, my personal AI reported. Items 11, 13, and 15 have been purchased for the buy-now price.
Time left on remaining items?
14 hours and 7 minutes.
There are almost as many ways to make money in the zone as there are ways to die. Almost. The most common is salvage.
The New York State court system ruled that anything found and recovered inside the exclusion zone was the property of the finder. Federal circuit court cases backed that decision. Finders keepers was the law of the zone, and Manhattan was chock full of stuff to find, from cash, gems, jewelry, art, furniture, fashion items, and electronics, to corporate secrets and proprietary information on standalone computer systems, all abandoned in the attack. The Johnson family had proven to be experts at monetizing the zone. Initially, Brad and my father had brought out cash that they recovered from stores and banks. Nowadays, the JR team just went in hell-bent for leather, raided an art gallery, jewelers, or even an haute fashion store, and bulled their way back out. Only licensed recovery agents were allowed onto the island, but the Johnsons also acted as guides, highly paid ones, for rich people who wanted to experience shooting a Chinese Raptor drone or firing a 50-caliber anti-material rifle into a Tiger ground unit. Then there were the massive studio fees paid to the on-air talent that made Zone War the top show on the globe. Yes, the other teams contributed to the popularity, but the attractive Scandinavian war family was top draw. If you don't believe me, just count the ads you see, some or all of them in, hawking everything from the latest workout clothes to Astrid's own line of makeup for combat to JJ's signature basketball shoes. As wealthy as they had become, the JR team's approach to salvage left a lot to be desired, especially if you wanted a really tricky recovery, like, say, corporate intellectual property left on the 22nd floor of a downtown high-rise. Their bull-in-a-china-shop approach stirred up every drone in a half-mile radius, leaving them with just a handful of minutes to extract their valuables before the sheer numbers would overwhelm even their heavily armored vehicles. That's where I came in. Gurung Extraction had a sterling reputation for bringing back hard-to-recover items. That's because I'm stealthy AF. Slip in and slip out. Part training by my sniper dad and part tech magic of my own design. The things I was selling on the Zonite auction site were just extra, mostly jewelry that I found along my way. We also had the beginnings of a pretty good family bank account going, the result of stashing any and all cash picked up during my zone travels. That was going to pay the twins' way through college, but the real money came from specific recovery missions.
You have 3 new queries for services?
Summarize, please. For some reason, I was always polite with AI. Most people weren't. It just seemed right somehow.
1 is a request for choice items for sports memorabilia housed in a private collection in the Upper West Side. The 2nd for recovery of legal papers from a personal residence. And the 3rd is a corporate query for proprietary software in a Wall Street trading office.
Triage, please.
The corporate request is the only one that meets or exceeds your risk-reward minimum offer. The sports request is not remotely rewarding enough, and the stated offer for the legal papers is far below the corporate query. Additionally, there is a time-adjusted bonus for the recovery of the computer records.
Display. The one blank wall in my room lit up with the email, including 2 financial numbers, the main offer and the bonus, each of which were large enough to make me set my ice cream aside. Somebody really wanted their algorithms. Which immediately begged the question as to why now, 10 years later. Actually, reading the email all the way through answered that question, or at least provided an answer. Zone recovery rates of success have not been deemed sufficient until now to attempt salvage, I read out loud. Somebody's been paying attention to Gurung Extraction, I mused. The corporate name on the email was something called the Zeus Global Finance Corporation.
Correct. ISP addresses assigned to Zeus Global Finance began viewing the Gurung Extraction website 2 weeks ago. Additional bot searches on the web have left sufficient evidence to indicate a relatively deep review of Gurung assignments to date.
I thought about the offer, then reread the few details of the extraction that were listed. Did Zeus Global have an office on Wall Street?
Negative. However, the Zeus website lists 2 corporate executive officers who were employed by a different firm, now defunct, that did have offices near Wall Street 10 years ago.
The wall view changed to list the two officers as the Chief Investment Officer and Chief Financial Officer, complete with pictures, as well as a side-by-side map of Lower Manhattan with a building highlighted in yellow, located on Broadway about a block from Wall Street. "Add in known salvage team activity for today's date and tomorrow," I instructed. The map on the wall suddenly showed three new highlights in red, green, and blue, respectively. There were currently five teams on Zone Wars, and one of the government's stipulations regarding the show was complete disclosure of each team's daily location plans. Independent salvage people like myself did not have to disclose any information other than designating our chosen zone entry point and our intended egress site. Proposed trip duration was also collected, but that was just so the zone defense people could alert our primary contacts if we went overdue. That was it. Nobody would be coming in after us if we didn't come out on our own. During its 4 years of production, Zone War had followed a total of 12 teams. Seven of them had either died or quit the business during that time. The actual number of salvage people lost in the zone was currently at 162. The survival rate was so low that the production company only occasionally picked new teams and only from people with several years of experience. Myself, I had close to 8 years of experience, most of it with my father. After Brad and J.J. Johnson, I was probably the most experienced salvager out there. Flottercott Productions had approached me exactly three times to be on the show, once a year for 3 years running, but much to the dismay of my sisters, I had turned them down all three times. No way was I allowing a drone camera to follow me around, giving away all my secrets. And there wasn't a camera team anywhere that could survive accompanying me, even if I was to ever give permission. I personally doubted any of them were stupid enough to try. My longevity in the world's deadliest job was directly due to my highly personalized approach and my very customized technology. Inform the sender that I agree to attempt the extraction, strike any guarantee clauses and disclosure amendments, I instructed my AI. "Done," it replied. "Okay, now we need to get down to planning." My father was huge on planning. Massive time was spent on every aspect of a recovery before we ever set foot in the zone. No detail too small. I could quote every drone's specifications forward and backward by the time I was 12. Nowadays, 2 years after his death, I have an exhaustive databank of information built up in my AI's drives. My planning is still just as thorough, just generally a whole lot faster. First, we reviewed current satellite footage of the building's neighborhood on Broadway, then pulled blueprints on the building itself from the NYC Department of Buildings database. The laptop in question was thought to be on the 17th floor, which was gonna be a bitch. Better than the 37th floor, which the building had, but still, dragging myself, my stealth suit, and my gear up 17 flights of stairs was gonna suck. Hard. Suggest carrying cutting torch, bolt cutters, and titanium pry bar. The state of the building is completely unknown. No record of other recoveries occurring at that address. Great. My AI was right, of course. Getting in and out of multi-story buildings could and often did require serious abilities to break and enter. All of my gear was miniaturized, but my pack weight and the resulting suck factor went up with every ounce. "I'll go through the Brooklyn Battery Tunnel entrance," I decided. "Concur. That will place you far from the Chelsea Pier entrance. Johnson Recovery and Igorov Salvage are both scheduled for entrance to the zone at that point tomorrow. Diversion rate is estimated to be 64.8%. Diversion rate was my own proprietary measure calculated by my AI using satellite footage, Zone War production crew drone counts, and my own drone counts measured at the same time if I happened to be in the zone. I got the idea watching one of the few full episodes I had ever sat through. At some point during the episode, I realized that someone or some AI on the studio team kept a running tally of observed drones at the bottom of the screen. The producers used it to raise the viewing tension, as the number would race higher the longer a team was in the zone and the more noise they made. I myself kept a running count of any and all combat units that I observed during my forays, along with the time observed. After egress, I would give that information, along with details on which models and makes I had seen, to my AI. 25,000 was the estimated number of drones released in the attack, an entire ship's hold's worth. Since that time, thousands had been killed or damaged in the course of the passing years and the active action of the salvage crews. The U.S. government paid a hefty bounty for every unit that could be confirmed destroyed, with varying payouts depending on the sophistication and danger each unit posed. Also, Air Force render drones hunted the high altitudes, preying on any visible drones, and marksman units on barricade duty sniped as many drones as they could see. There were a couple of mothership drones that had onboard 3D printers that could make small replacement drones, but otherwise the number was estimated to be dwindling, perhaps as low as 15,000 drones remaining. Unfortunately, the most lethal and sophisticated units that were the best at killing humans were also best at avoiding their own destruction. The bounty for an Indian tiger hunter killer was north of $200,000, and forget about one of the three remaining Chinese spider C-3 units thought to be at large. Each command, control, and communication master drone could orchestrate up to 300 lesser drones at a time. They had been the most highly advanced units in the Chinese arsenal at the time of the attack, equipped with real progressive machine learning software that was capable of rewriting itself to adapt to the battlefield. One spider had been destroyed at the end of the second week of the Manhattan attack. That single unit had coordinated battle drones that killed an estimated 230 soldiers, cops, and federal agents. The fact that three such units were still unaccounted for was likely the main reason the military hadn't gone back into Manhattan in force. So the bounty on a Spider C-3 was approaching $1 million. Cheap, if you ask me. You might wonder if we didn't have more advanced drones now, 10 years later, that could go in and fight the battles without human lives being lost. We do, and it didn't work. The C-3s kept learning, kept adapting, kept growing. They beat the more advanced drones sent against them. In fact, the information in their CPUs, the software that they wrote and rewrote over 10 years, would be worth, in my estimation, closer to $1 billion. Every army on Earth would pay up for it. Some people wonder if any of the C-3s are still active, still functioning. I can personally vouch for two. Scariest moment of my life. 18 months ago, in the north end of Central Park, I use the park often as the drones tend to stay in the more urban areas, not because they don't function well in the park, but because the park is full of deer and coyotes and a small number of animals that escaped the Central Park Zoo. Combat drones are designed and programmed for killing humans. They ignore animals. But having that many warm bodies clouding their thermal senses is confusing to most drones, costly in processing power. So they tend to stay out of the park, which makes the park one of my favorite places. Anyway, I was skirting through the woods and came upon the edge of the old softball fields. It was a really nice, sunny summer day, and I sensed motion out on the overgrown field. Dad's lessons kept me deep in the shadows, peeking over a small hummock of rock and dirt, my low thermal signature camouflage hood over my head. Through my monocular, I saw a veritable army of drones, motionless, solar collectors spread out for maximum charging value. Right in the middle of four tank killers, seven tigers, about 20 Russian wolves, and a veritable flock of various flying units were two C-3s sitting in the open, charging batteries like the rest. The C-3s look like their nickname, spiders, black-painted armored spiders, each the size of a sofa love seat, except these spiders have seven legs, not eight. The horde stayed that way for an hour, then suddenly the entire battle group of drones activated all at once and flew, crawled, or rolled off to the east, leaving me in a pile of sweat and maybe a little urine. Maybe more than a little. I bring out dead drones fairly regularly, but mostly just small ones, or I yank the CPUs and ID plates from bigger ones. I don't have a heavy electro-powered hybrid LAV to haul my catches, so my paid kills are kinda low. My actual tagged kill numbers are a different story.
The zone is my real office, and salvage my work. And work is good. Tomorrow, I'd head into the Manhattan drone zone. Chapter 3. I inserted the next day, calling for an Ublift car to transport me and my gear to the Brooklyn Battery Tunnel. Self-drivers aren't allowed in the tunnel, only military or salvage company vehicles, and they have to be manually driven ones at that. Catching a ride with a zone military driver that I knew, I tried going over my plan as I rode. Fat chance. My driver turned out to be quite a chatty Cathy.
"Yo, Gunga Din, what you got going today?"
Corporal Lynx asked. I had quoted the final line of the old Kipling poem once to him, and since that day, he'd called me Gunga Din. Ignorant bastard didn't even know that the fictional Gunga was Indian, while I'm Nepali-American. "You know, just thought I'd go skipping around Wall Street and find some old stock certificates I can forge my name on," I said.
"You can do that?"
he asked, brows raised, looking at me and not the road.
"Nobody has used certificates in decades," I said, shaking my head and pointing at the left-hand tunnel wall that we were about to slam into. "Oh, not spilling your real deal, huh?"
he said, swerving back to center.
"You don't trust me,"
he stated, now pissy.
"Confidentiality agreements in my contracts. My clients don't want me giving out any of their secrets,"
I said, which was true. I wouldn't have told him anyway. OPSEC, operational security. Dad was huge on that one. Any mission information you gave out would travel faster than a bullet and could be just as deadly. Lynx kept silent, not speaking for the rest of the trip, which was fine with me. We arrived at the zone checkpoint, Battery Park, which actually lies under the park in what used to be the old Battery Underpass. Lynx let me off before taking his load of supplies to the zone quartermaster. I thanked him, but he just gave me a nod and drove away. I know for a fact that a lot of the zone guards collect under-the-table money from reporters about any juicy salvage gossip, and Corporal Lynx was definitely one of them. The fact that I didn't give away much of anything informational was a sore point for him, like I was shorting him his additional pay. Never mind that it was part and parcel of my zone protocol, and one that helped keep me alive. Soldiers, like all people, talk, and often by phone. Drones can hear phones. Nuff said.
"Ah, Mr. Gurung, what brings you to our little slice of heaven here in the battery?"
the entrance sergeant asked, holding out his hand for my pack.
"You know, Sergeant Alonzo, just looking for my personal pot of gold. Heard the rainbow came down on the other side of those steel doors,"
I said as I carefully watched him give my gear a casual but professional once over. Weapons, ammo, first aid, breaking and entering gear, distraction devices, booby trap gear, food and water. But no camo gear and no batteries. That was the rule unless you were going in as part of a team, and then only on an armored vehicle. Even the military special forces units that use the zone for training went camo free. Most Manhattanites lost their lives during the attack because they lacked all the right instincts. Modern humans were both totally reliant on electronics and so self-absorbed by them that they missed the danger cues all around them. They completely failed to react usefully to the drone threat, or once they realized it, called their own doom down upon themselves with those same phones. I've seen hundreds of bodies of people who died looking at their cell phones, which everyone seemed to have back then, before personal AIs. Many people died because they ran over each other, blocked up escape routes, or simply froze in place. People often failed each other as the veneer of civilization was ripped away and it became every man or woman for themselves. The majority of people tried to shelter in place. Then they called for help on those damned phones. Instead of rescue, they called the drones right to them. Even when the military tried overflights with speakers announcing to any survivors to leave their phones and attempt escape on their own, most still tried to call for help. Combat drones were built by humans to kill humans, and they built them very well. Almost every model in the invasion group had the capacity to detect and track electromagnetic signals. Most could find ways into buildings, open doors, or hack electronic locks and alarms.
and drones generally work in swarms or at least pairs. One would bang on the door while a flyer would drop down and shoot you through the window. So, we weren't supposed to bring electronic stuff in. Weapons galore, no problem. Personal comp and commo, no way. As if I needed to. I had a city of stuff that I had been combing for 8 years, and I certainly knew enough to avoid electronics, even electronic sights on my weapons.
Just your personal sidearm and your rifle, which you aren't even carrying? Alonzo asked.
Yep, and I don't usually need either of them, I said truthfully. Picking a fight with machines built for war was a really, really fast way to meet your maker. My weapons were either last-ditch, as in the case of my Ruger Wesson 5.7 pistol, or for harvesting particularly juicy drones, which was the purpose of my heavy-caliber suppressed rifle.
How the hell do you do it, kid? Alonzo wondered.
I'd heard the same question 1,000 times before. I shrugged, collecting my gear and stepping up to the entrance line.
He's clear,
Alonzo yelled, giving the door operator a wave. I heard another voice then, one I instantly recognized.
Hey, look, the weasel's slinking away.
I turned and met the eyes of Martin Johnson, second-born and middle child of the Johnson clan. He held a tablet out toward Alonzo, the kind of thing the Zone Wars teams used to file plans with the Zone Authority. But the massive steel door had begun to open, and I turned away from the middle Johnson and walked into the clean room chamber. Just what I needed. Instant distraction at the worst possible moment, as all of my attention should be focused on the zone outside the next door. There was a flat screen mounted on the wall next to the outer door that showed 3 separate camera views and a diagram listing electromagnetic scan results. Nothing on screen, and the scan was clear of dots representing drones. Normal. Drones didn't hang out near the entrances we use because the autocannons and laser weapons mounted above them tended to make short work of killer machines. No, the dangerous ground would be the area just outside of the gun's kill zones. I hit the outer door control, the one for the smaller human-sized door, not the big vehicle door, and waited for it to cycle open, taking at least that time to consider Martin's presence. Astrid, I had always liked. While JJ was 6 years older than me and had been a bit of a hero of mine when I was a kid, Martin, though, was always an asshole. Middle child with attention issues and more than a bit of narcissism. Couldn't compete with Astrid's beauty or his older, bigger brother's handsome sex appeal, so he was bitter and petty to all those he could be, which had often been me back in the day. Nowadays, our interactions were rare, but usually consisted of trading insults. But more important than his being a giant douche was the fact that his presence meant that there must have been a change of plans regarding Johnson Recovery's intended incursion for the day. And that wasn't good for me. The very last place I needed or wanted to be was anywhere near the clusterfuck that was JR in action. My area of operation would be knee-deep in drones for the rest of the day once they began slamming their way around the zone. The door opened enough for me to slip out, and that's just what I did, putting my retrospection on Team Johnson on hold for the moment and instead concentrating on my surroundings. Behind me, the door reversed and closed almost silently. When Team Johnson came through, they'd use the giant vehicle doors and make all kinds of racket. I had better be far, far away by then. Like any driving tunnel in a city, the road rose up at an angle to meet the surface streets, concrete retaining walls rising up on either side. Ahead of me, the center of the road was open, husks of abandoned cars shoved against either retaining wall. I crouched, listening, smelling, and watching, my only motion the act of pulling up the hood on my stealth suit. Let's talk about stealth suits for a moment. Mine is pretty good, maybe not state-of-the-art like active soldiers are issued, but still pretty good. It better be, because it cost like crazy. The outer layer is optically reactive, like a chameleon skin, changing colors to blend in with the immediate environment. In fact, it was closely copied from nature, using nanochemistry instead of electronics to provide the best camouflage available, short of a Potter cloak. Those, which I leave you to guess why they are so named, used electro-optics to bend light around an object and thus hide it perfectly. Worked great for humans, but not so well with drones. The electromagnetic signature was low, but still detectable by drone sensors. Stealth suits had no such problem. The energy for the chemical changes in a stealth suit came from the wearer's own body heat, which had the secondary effect of reducing the wearer's thermal signature. Additional thermal reduction came from the internal cooling system, activated by muscle movement to circulate coolant throughout the suit. Accumulated heat was stored in insulated heat sinks in the soles of the boots that were attached to the suit. Overall, the thermal effectiveness depended a great deal upon the weather and environment you found yourself in. Cold weather, rainstorms, puddles of water, or actual streams were my best friends because of the small ports that I could dial open in the soles of the boots, allowing a really rapid dispersion of heat. Dry, hot summer weather was harder. Not impossible, but it really took a whole different approach to move about the zone in the dog days of July and August. Stealth suits also had a charcoal layer to absorb odors and biological telltales that could also alert drones. Additionally, there was a thin layer of Kevlar just under the optical layer to stop some of the shrapnel tracking tags that some drones used, and it could even slow down fletchets. Not armor, like J.J. Johnson wears, but way better than regular clothing. I moved down the open road slowly and carefully, head swiveling as I opened up all of my senses, feeling the breeze and getting into my own zone. In the zone. No pun intended. I stayed tight up to the left side retaining wall. I've noticed a tendency of drones to cluster on the left side of passageways, roads, and hallways, although not all do it. I don't know if that's deliberate programming or not. I think it is. There is a perception that people tend to turn right or stay right more than left. Not sure if that's actually a true thing, and I think the programmers plugged that into their algorithms. It doesn't really matter if it's true human nature or not, as long as I can use that trait to my advantage. If drones were hanging in and on the high-rises to my left, then the defilated area against the left wall was dead space that couldn't be engaged from the left side. I used the smashed cars to give me cover from the right. The next part was tricky. I was still in view of the zone authority cameras, but getting really close to the end of the entrance's kill zone, the part where the retaining walls were down to a meter in height, the tunnel exit ramp almost level with the street. I was going to be extremely exposed in short order, and so I had to execute a bit of misdirection to keep my observers from learning my secrets, all while using those very same secrets to stay alive. From a pocket on my stealth suit came a little spring-loaded device. It had started life as a mini flare launcher, but was now modified to toss a little sonic package a distance of 25 meters. I did exactly that, lobbing the screamer over the wall and onto an open sidewalk, where it began to belt out a tone that would probably make me cringe if my human ears could have heard it. Pitched just above dog whistle range, it was actually a series of sound bursts in a complex pattern. I know what you're thinking. Ajaya, you lazy bastard. Are you so weak you can't even throw a 5-gram object? Nah, I just don't want to make a big, giant, attention-getting arm motion and maybe get laced with a couple of dozen fletchets drilled through the skull by a laser or blown up by a mini bomblet. The sonic screamer activated a bit off to my side, so I hunkered down between the last wrecked car on the tunnel ramp and half a meter of retaining wall. Nothing to do now but wait. Possibly anywhere from 5 minutes to maybe 20 or 25. The car next to me was a Kia, both windows on my side shattered, probably by kinetic fire from one of the bigger land drones during the first days of the attack. Most of the big units came ashore armed with full loads of ammo for their autoguns. Most, especially the Chinese ground raptors and the Indian leopard units, had pretty complex ammunition usage programs that maximized the economical deployment of limited and irreplaceable rounds. During the initial attack, these units used automatic weapons fire, but most switched to single-shot mode when they dropped to 75% of munitions loadout. From there, the drone would calculate to optimize the effectiveness of their weapons use. 10 years later, these drones had almost all exhausted their ammo supplies. Only fletchet shooters, which could fabricate raw ammo from any available wire stock, and laser-armed units were still capable of ranged fire. The empty gun shooters were still dangerous, adaptive combat programming allowing them to rearm with close-quarters weapons like fire axes or anything that could bludgeon or cut. They also could use human firearms, which was one reason my father, myself, and every salvage person I knew policed up any stray weapons we came across. A piece of fabric fluttered in the shattered car window, a tattered scrap of faded pinkish material that once might have been silk. It took a second before I realized it was the tip of a scarf. I felt no inclination to look into the car and see the scarf's wearer. You probably wonder about smell, but 10 years after the attack, most bodies are now just weathered bone, which is where Cade and Kyle Bonin had taken the inspiration for their team name, the Bone Shakers. I sometimes find remains that have been completely desiccated, like an Egyptian mummy, usually in the upper floors of a high-rise building where sunlight and intact windows worked to dry the body like jerky in an oven. But most of the dead are just bones. My sonic screamer attracted just one drone, a long-bodied Russian wolf, its green camouflage paint chipped and scraped, but its motions still an eerie approximation of a real dog. I doubted it was alone. Usually an aerial UAV works with a land-based UGV, especially out here in the open. But my homemade screamers are pitched so high that they mostly fail to trip the human-based parameters that drones hunted by. There are always exceptions, as the wolf was demonstrating. A shadow shot across the road, cars and buildings, a flyer moving fast across the open sky. I looked up, but it had gone by too quick for me to see much more than a blur. Still, it was enough. My wait was over. Keeping one eye on the wolf, I put an actual antique dog whistle to my lips and gave a short, quick blast. The wolf lifted its coffee can-sized metal head and turned visual sensor panels in my direction. The screamer kept screaming, and I refrained from any more whistles, movements, or even deep breaths. The hound lifted one metal foot as if to investigate, but then its head abruptly tilted up, taking in an object that dropped from the sky like a meteor. U.S. Air Force render drones own the high altitudes over Manhattan, but the undisputed master of the low-altitude urban airspace in the zone was, without question, the Russian Berkut, the Death Eagle. The Berkut was a sophisticated flying transformer whose shape could shift from a round hovering ball to a sleek, streamlined fighter-shaped missile that could drop on its prey at 400 kilometers per hour and either skewer it on its spear-shaped front nose or shoot it with its 9mm by 21mm firearm. The arrow-shaped object shot toward the ground like a bullet, then suddenly pulled up, the V-wings shifting and collapsing as the segmented body rolled up like a grapefruit-sized carbon fiber pill bug, the whole thing hovering on four powerful turbofans. The wolf paused, silently communing with the Berkut, then turning and moving off to the north. The Berkut spun around slowly in place, scanning the area. It suddenly tilted two of its four hover fans and shot my way. 2 seconds later, it was right in front of me, gun barrel in my face. "Hello, Ricky Ticky," I said softly, so the retreating hound wouldn't hear. Chapter 4. At the sound of my voice, LED lights lit up across the front of the deadly drone, and a soft ticking sound came from its speakers. My clenched stomach relaxed. Part of me always expects it to shoot me dead.
Voice recognition complete. Facial recognition complete. Hello, AJ,
it said in a quiet, slightly tinny British voice. I had wanted to change that to a Nepali-accented voice, but there was only so much reprogramming I could do without messing up Ricky Ticky's best features. Oh, and yes, I know about Kipling. I hate much of what he wrote, as did my father. We also loved some of what he wrote. Both feelings are possible with one writer. All things come with both good and bad, Ajaya, my father used to say. It is up to us to find and polish the good and push away the bad. Ricky hovered, waiting.
Target is 55 Broadway, I said, keeping my voice just above a whisper.
Currently 7 drone units between this location and Target. Sensor override 96% likely to succeed. Distance 0.48 kilometers.
Ricky Tikki is my ace in the hole, a reprogrammed drone whose upgraded processor was sophisticated and powerful enough to override the base programming of many of the drones still in the zone, at least within ranges that were up close and personal. I rose from my crouch, the hovering killer drone now leading me through the zone to my target destination like a pet dog. Eat that, Johnson Recovery. I caught Ricky when my father died. I'd been obsessed with the drones since the night my family evacuated Manhattan, with me carrying Monique and Astrid carrying Gabby. I helped my father study the units that inhabited the zone, and even got my hands on some of the units that he and Brad Johnson brought out in the early years. The Berkuts fascinated me as much as the spiders scared me. They were designed to hunt soldiers and law enforcement. Silent, swift, and armed with a powerful 9mm weapon whose steel cored bullets were created to defeat body armor. I almost destroyed Ricky, came mere microseconds from pounding his fantastically engineered frame into scrap. My father's words stopped me. Now, Ricky helped me provide for the family and survive the zone. My high school had a drone technician's college credit course offered through a local community college, and I got hooked. The 2-year degree from the same college gave me the tools I eventually used when I captured Ricky. Core code, rewrite of the CPU, upgrade a bunch of components here and there, tweak the batteries and capacitors, repair the damage that happened during his capture, and voila, my own drone escort. Perhaps I'm oversimplifying everything I did, especially the software work. Maybe, but that's part of my secret. An escort that could still talk to every other drone in the zone and convince most of them that the human target their sensors reported in Ricky's proximity was an anomaly. A sensor phantom, erroneous data to be overridden by the Berkut's much closer sensors and more powerful processor. We moved at a pretty good pace, still as stealthy as possible. Ricky's subterfuge depends on me giving as little concrete evidence as possible. Every bit of my stealth suit technology and sniper stalking skill is required, but the complete knowledge Ricky has of the drones around us allowed me to move faster for bursts between the drones. When we got close to a patrolling or stationary drone, I had to really be careful. And that's when our pace slowed way down. Mostly we looped around the deadly machines, but at times that was impossible, and we had to pass close to them. In the 2 years I've had Ricky, the sensor suppression gig has failed only a handful of times. Those episodes resulted in sudden gunfire, me with my full auto, suppressed 5.7, and Ricky with his internal 9mm. Ricky would then report to the greater drone net that the human intruder was killed at the cost of one drone. So far, it had worked, but I avoided those situations like the plague. Gunfights with drones are terrifying. They have machine quick reaction times and computer corrected aim. My only chance is overwhelming firepower from both myself and my guardian Berkut. That and the fact that most drones are either ammo depleted or shoot lightweight fletchets or underpowered lasers. As you might imagine, Ricky's ammo hoppers are the only regularly refilled magazines in the zone. I scavenged, hand-loaded, and mail-ordered the odd Russian ammo wherever and whenever I could to keep them topped up with both full power and subsonic rounds. My pack was always inspected upon entering the zone, but no one ever looked at the odd caliber rounds I was packing. Ammo was ammo, and frankly, the huge .338 Lapua armor-piercing rounds my rifle ate usually got the most attention. 55 Broadway was only half a click from Battery Park. Back in the day, it would have taken less than 10 minutes to walk there. Now it took an hour and 10 minutes. Still not bad, but then the 37-story office building was looming over me, taunting me with the knowledge that I had 17 floors to climb with a full pack that went over 25 kilos, even though much of my gear was aluminum, plastic, or titanium. Nothing to it but to do it. Ricky scanned the building lobby through the 2 revolving doors. No drones. Lots of skeletons, but no drones.
One of the lobby spinning doors was jammed open by the skeleton of a man in a security uniform. I stepped over him, foot coming down carefully so as not to snap any bones. That would be disrespectful. And noisy. Noisy is bad. Moving deeper into the building, I looked everywhere. What looked like four more skeletons were spread in pieces all across the floor. Just based on that, I would have guessed dogs, but the big piles of dried dog shit absolutely confirmed it. For the first 5 years after Drone Night, dogs were a huge issue. Left behind by panicking New Yorkers and ignored by the drones, dogs were everywhere, and they really only had one ready food source to work with. For a time, they were well-fed, but as that primary food supply disappeared down the throats of rats, roaches, ants, foxes, more roaches, cats, raccoons, skunks, vultures, crows, ravens, and the dogs themselves, man's abandoned best friend grew hungry. Feral and hungry, with a taste for their former masters. I've shot more dogs than anyone should ever have to. Some days, Dad and I would have to post up on the edge of the zone and cull a pack with suppressed NYPD M4 carbines liberated from empty police stations. I hated those days. In those early years, the packs often kept us from getting more than a few blocks into the zone. Worse, the drones learned to pay attention when a pack was following us. Only proximity to the containment wall and its automatic anti-drone guns kept us alive some days. I like dogs, a lot, but I'll be honest, after seeing packs of 30 or 40 feral mutts tear apart a Central Park deer, then follow our scent trail because they were still starving, well, let's just say I have a trust issue. And it's not the dog's fault. Abandoned and surviving as best as they could, they became what nature always intended. There are a lot fewer now. The easy food lying in the streets is gone, and New York winters are still harsh, so only the strongest have survived. Which means they're much better hunters and killers than the early packs, just fewer and more spread out. It's one of the major reasons I spray my boots with fox piss. In case you're wondering, I buy the commercial stuff like regular hunters. I wouldn't have a clue on how to harvest it myself. The global recession brought sustenance hunting back in a big way, as people found old ways to feed their families, and these days the overpopulation of suburban deer are a thing of the past. One of the 8 elevators had its door jammed open on a briefcase and what looked like a femur. The others were shut, but of course there was no power in the building. City maintenance shut the whole borough off when satellite and Air Force drone surveillance showed the terrorist drones tapping into the power grid to recharge. So it was the stairwell and 17 stories of stairs. My father always insisted on constant physical conditioning, but at least I was smarter these days. "Ricky, Scout," I said, pointing up. My drone rose up the stairwell, disappearing from view for 7 or 8 minutes, then returning to report no collapsed stairs or blocked doors, and most importantly, no drones. That meant I could leave much of my braking and entering gear behind. I could bring one titanium pry bar, small acetylene cutter, lockpicks, water, snacks, escape and evasion gear, and of course, my rifle. 8 kilos of sniper rifle and ammo is a lot, but you never know what you'll see when you're 17 stories high.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.